How to buy a home in Vancouver, even if you make the minimum wage. Vancouver, British Columbia, one of the most desirable cities in the world. People from all over come here every year looking for a better life. Many of them who came here decades ago started out as working class immigrants, and now they own multiple properties. How's that possible? Well, they used a proven system that's been around since the greatest generation, and is simpler than most people think. As someone who grew up in this fabulous city, I have struggled with making low wages before, and I have also experienced the joy of home ownership. So right now I'm going to explain how to buy your first home here in Vancouver without making a high income or getting financial help from parents. First, calculate how much you can afford to buy so you can figure out your down payment. Next, make a plan to come up with this down payment. This is where you make a budget and track your spending. And finally, get approved for financing from a bank or mortgage broker and go out and buy your home. So that's the overview, but there are some nuances that you should be aware of, so let me elaborate each step in detail. Some people might be skeptical of this idea, but I'm going to break down step by step exactly how this works and share the math behind this strategy. Let's use a young couple as an example. When Harry met Sally, they were making minimum wage, working at a restaurant together. Not long after they started dating, Harry received a notice from his landlord to move out because his apartment was being renovated. This is a huge problem. You see, Harry cannot afford to go anywhere else because the current rental market is way more expensive than when he first started renting years ago. Rent control only affects existing rents, but not new lease agreements. So unfortunately, Harry was being evicted through no fault of his own, and for the first time in his life, he feared the possibility of becoming homeless. That's when his girlfriend suggested he can move in with her. Harry felt so relieved and thankful for Sally's offer. Things continued to go well for them, and after living together for some time, they decided to plan for their future together. As a creative individual, Sally really likes to decorate, but her strict landlord wouldn't let her make any changes to her unit, and Harry was determined to never feel so powerless as he did during the rent eviction. Instead of living in frustration under other people's rules, Harry and Sally one day decided to take control of their own circumstances. So they made a financial commitment to purchase their very own home in Vancouver, no matter what it takes. Luckily, they don't have any student loan or other forms of debt because they haven't gone to college yet, but they also don't have any personal savings. Well, that's about to change, so let's dive into this three-step process to buy a Vancouver property on a low household income. First, Harry and Sally have to calculate how much home they can buy. Income is the most important thing to determine their borrowing capacity. So Harry and Sally both make minimum wage, working full-time at 40 hours a week. Minimum wage today, as determined by the provincial government, is $15.20 per hour. This gives them a combined household income of just over $63,000. Lenders have specific formulas to determine how much a new home buyer can borrow. For conventional mortgages, this generally works out to roughly 5 times the gross income. In this case, 5 times their household income is just over $316,000. This is how much mortgage they can potentially borrow. They plan to make a 20% down payment because they don't want mortgage insurance. So if they borrow 80% of a home's purchase price, then their budget for a property should be $395,200. Let's round this down to $390 to make it simple, and we don't want to stretch their finances too thin. That's not a lot of money to buy a place in Vancouver, but it is certainly enough to get them a starter home. I'll show some examples of properties in this price range later. The immediate question for now is, how will they come up with the 20% down payment if they're earning minimum wage? Well, this brings us to step two, which takes the longest to carry out, but is also the most exciting part because they can really get creative with different ways to save money. So Harry and Sally make a budget and they stick with it, and here's what that looks like. Rent, $750. There's a lot of long-term affordable accommodation in the Greater Vancouver area. You have some choices like this one-bedroom suite in Richmond that also comes with its own private entrance and comes with utilities, including high-speed internet. If you don't mind sharing a common area, here's an excellent furnished unit in Vancouver proper. It's within walking distance to public transportation and comes with all the basic amenities. Further out into the adjacent municipalities, you can find even cheaper accommodation in Surrey or Coquitlam. There's a lot of affordable options in the suburbs. Some of these places might feel a little small, but for Harry and Sally, this is only a temporary situation until they find their own place. They're happy to live anywhere as long as there are functional appliances and everything is up to code, because their main priority is on saving for their down payment. Next on the budget is groceries, and this is $400 per month. Instead of paying full price for their food, Harry and Sally like to shop at discount grocers. independent markets such as Consumers Produce in East Vancouver has some of the best deals in the city. The Crystal Mall Market in Burnaby also has a lot of affordable produce, meat, and seafood. I recently visited there and bought a large bag of fresh groceries for just under $18. I then went to the Real Canadian Superstore, which is literally one block away, and I picked up the exact same food. Guess how much I paid? Almost $29. That's 60% more expensive, and the prices can be dramatically different depending on what you buy. At Crystal Mall, for example, zucchinis are under $1 a pound. That's less than half the price of what Superstore charges. Again, the two stores are just a few minutes away from each other on foot. Vancouverites can save 30 or 40% on their total grocery bill just by choosing cheaper places to shop. After my price comparison experiment, I tried the food from these different grocery stores, and surprise, surprise, they taste exactly the same. To be fair, large popular chains like Loblaw does provide better customer service. The receipt is itemized properly instead of just using generic labels. And they have flyers, advertisements, and printed price stickers. All of these, of course, cost money. But not everybody cares about presentation and service. Harry and Sally already know what they want to buy, so they're perfectly fine just helping themselves, picking what they want, paying for it, and then leave. Right next door to this produce store is a discount butcher shop where you can pick up 2 pounds of meat for about $7. Again, cheaper than most other places. But that doesn't mean there aren't good deals to be had at big box stores. Walmart is great for staples like bread, milk, and eggs. 10 tortillas for $2.57? Yes, please. You can also find deep discounted items sometimes. Whenever they have a great deal, I buy it. I recently picked up a few things from Walmart, and I got all of this for $10.51. Luckily for Harry and Sally, they can both cook since they work at a restaurant, so here are some ways they can use the ingredients mentioned so far. Divide the beef into quarter-pound patties, sear on each side, and make mushroom burgers. The cost of each of these burgers is just $2. Having one is already quite filling, so you won't have mushroom for a second. For the ground pork, you can fry it up, mix in some veggies, and make sausage burritos. Again, each one is under $2. For vegetarian dishes, this has been one of the cheapest dishes I've made recently at just $1 a plate. And here are some air-fried seasonal vegetables. You don't need to spend a lot of money on food to enjoy delicious and healthy meals. According to a Daily Hive article, the average person in Vancouver spends about $218 a month on groceries. But by going to discount grocers and buying discounted items, Harry and Sally can easily stay below $200 each, or $400 combined. This is a fairly common practice for many people around the city. My friend Chrissy interviewed a married couple in North Vancouver, and they spent $400 a month on groceries because they also discovered that you can buy food from ethnic shops at a fraction of the cost of regular supermarkets. The next budget item is utilities. Internet is already covered in most rental situations, as well as heating and electricity. So the only thing Harry and Sally really have to pay for themselves are their cell phone plans. And there are lots of options out there for less than $40 a month that will give you unlimited calls and texts. So they can each have their own phone plans, and it shouldn't be more than $80 per month combined. Vancouver has a fairly robust transportation system, except when it snows. But you can pretty much get anywhere you want, and a two-zone monthly pass is $134, so $300 a month should be more than enough for a couple to get around the city. And finally, there's miscellaneous spending, and this is a catch-all category for everything else that's not already included, and it includes things like eating out, gifts, entertainment, clothing, toiletries, and tenant insurance if their landlord requires it or if they want it. $300 a month is allocated towards this. All of their spending together comes to a total of $1,830 a month. Of course, they're both enrolled in the medical service plan, which doesn't cost them anything. So now let's see how much money they earn every month. Based on the Wealthsimple income tax calculator, someone making minimum wage can expect to take home $26,469 after tax. That's a combined net income of just under $53,000 a year, or $4,412 a month for this couple. So, moment of truth. If they earn $4,400 a month and they spend $1,830, then Harry and Sally can save $2,582 per month, and that's a savings rate of 59% on after-tax income. So, not too shabby for a couple making minimum wage in Vancouver. Since they're looking for a home to buy worth potentially $390,000, they will need to save $78,000 for the 20% down payment. As first-time home buyers, the couple doesn't have to pay any property transfer tax, but let's add $2,000 for moving and closing costs, for a total of $80,000 that they need to have in liquid assets in order to purchase a home. So how long will it take them to have this much? 31 months. That's about 2.5 years. And if they find something cheaper than $390,000, then they can buy even sooner. When saving up for a home purchase, just putting money away in a savings account might not be the best idea because you're earning less interest than inflation, essentially losing purchasing power. I'm working on another video right now to demonstrate a more optimized strategy to save for a down payment, so you don't have to keep chasing the market if it goes higher. I'll upload that one when it's finished later on. In any case, after saving diligently for the next couple of years, Harry and Sally get ready for the final stage of their home buying journey. They get pre-approved and start looking for a suitable home. Here are some recent affordable listings in Vancouver they can potentially consider. This one bedroom plus den is part of a co-op community in Oak Ridge. It's been renovated with new vinyl flooring and a fresh coat of paint. It's not the biggest apartment, but it could be a great starter home for a young couple. However, co-ops can be difficult to finance due to their share loan structure, so if they want a freehold property, this one is currently being sold near Joyce SkyTrain Station, and from there it's only a 15-minute ride to downtown Vancouver. Again, not very big, but for $380,000, this is a really good value. Let's also look at a couple of properties that were recently sold. This 552 square feet apartment changed hands this fall for $390,000, and it's right by downtown Vancouver. Here's another apartment that was sold just last month for $336,000. This one is a bit smaller at 432 square feet, but it's clean and has a decent floor plan. Now, if Harry and Sally are after more space, they can look further away from the city core. This spacious apartment in the up-and-coming Brentwood neighborhood is asking for $349,000 and offers nearly 700 square feet of living space, and it has a large garden patio too. As you can see, there's no shortage of livable homes in Vancouver for under $400,000, so home ownership can be a reality for just about anyone, and that's honestly really good news for young people. It shows that they're not priced out of the housing market. Even if they earn the lowest possible wage that's legally permitted, they can still save up and buy a home in Vancouver within a reasonable time frame. It's all about practicing delayed gratification and having realistic expectations for a starter home. So after a few years of living well below their means, Harry and Sally found a property they really like. Their offer was approved, and just like that, they have become homeowners. Harry will never have to worry about getting kicked out of his own home, and Sally can design the place to her liking without asking for anyone else's permission. It may not be their dream home, but at least they're on the property ladder now. Two-thirds of their $1,083 monthly mortgage payment goes straight to paying off their principal during the first 5 years of the amortization. As they increase their wages and build up equity in their home over the years, they can eventually upgrade to a larger property if they need to. But this is the worst case scenario for the incomes. In all the places I've worked, the hourly rate of pay actually increases with experience or hours worked. And there's often the opportunity to work on holidays or do overtime and get paid extra. Plus, if you ever feel like you're being underpaid, just go to another company. This is especially easy to do now due to the shortage of workers. Businesses have to be very competitive with their wages now. One restaurant in Vancouver offered to pay $50,000 a year for a dishwasher position. Even under normal economic conditions, a worker who leaves one employer for another receives a raise between 10 to 20% on average. Not to mention all the side hustle opportunities out there these days. There are so many ways to increase one's income. Just because you start at minimum wage doesn't mean you have to stay there for the rest of your working life. So realistically speaking, as Harry and Sally are saving for their down payment, they can find ways to make more money. And with a higher household income, they can either buy a more expensive apartment or purchase something earlier than initially planned. Personal finance is often less about the money and more about aligning your values with your goals and having the right attitude so you stay on the right track. You don't always get what you want, but you will become what you believe to be true. And if you secretly believe home ownership is impossible for you, then you'll always live in somebody else's house, which isn't good or bad, but it's important to realize that your reality is shaped by what you focus your attention on. If you believe home ownership is attainable, despite your low income, then you can and you will find your name on a property's title someday. Just make sure you buy it for the right reasons and plan to hold it for at least 7 years. Don't try to flip houses. You can easily hurt yourself because they're really heavy. Unless, of course, you buy a light house. But you can also hurt yourself financially because you need a lot of experience to do that, and one mistake can be devastating to your personal finances. Just like the stock market, you will likely do better just by holding. The longer you own a quality piece of real estate, the more benefits it will produce for you. Like any international city, you can have a simple, frugal lifestyle and enjoy many of the free amenities offered here in Vancouver. Or you can spend a lot of money and experience all the luxuries the city has to offer. It's all up to you and what you choose to believe. If you prioritize homeownership, just realize that you will have to make some trade-offs. Maybe live in a smaller suite for a few years like Harry and Sally. Maybe rake leaves and water flower beds on weekends to reach your goals faster. That's how the world works. You can have pretty much anything you want. You just can't have everything you want. So whatever you choose to prioritize, make sure it's worth it to you, because you have to be willing to let go of almost everything else. I think anyone who plans to live in Vancouver long term should definitely consider owning some type of real estate here. My net worth over the last few years grew by more than $300,000 thanks in large part to my Vancouver properties. Last year, I carefully changed my portfolio holdings to take advantage of inflation, and the results did not disappoint. Inflation hurts consumers, but it benefits investors. And if you missed it earlier, I did a breakdown of my entire investment portfolio in this video, showing all the assets I have and explaining my reasons for buying them. Real estate is a great hedge against inflation, which is at an 18-year high right now, so that's why I'm currently overweight in this sector. Anyway, thanks a lot for watching. Happy investing, and until next time.